foundation.
What is which element is for what it will say about?
Then I will start at the beginning. Is that okay for everybody? Yes. It's actually a really funny story. You will be very unhappy about every book that you know about. So it's very simple. But first, like I said, fireplace actually needs a wuxing, right? And the wuxing theory was a theory separate from the yinyang theory. And in the Qing dynasty, they merged these two theories. And as a result, this was actually the birth of alchemical science. And for a lot of sciences too. And the interaction between the two was very important. So you can't see one without the other, right? So if you talk about wuxing, you talk about yin. You talk about yin, you talk about wuxing. Yin and wuxing together, they make a papa. Papa means the eight diagrams. I will talk about that later too. Because these are different extrapolations and then the interaction with them. They also describe the alchemical process, right? Just the chemistry of nature, you can say. But the thing is, we translate this elements, that's wrong. Sing just means the form, basically. Just like nature, say, sing, when we talk about it's the same sing, right? It's the form, it's the nature of something, it's the form of something, right? And the five forms, they are representing something very specific, which is usually called five qualities, right? And we talk about it a little bit later too. But first I start with the why people can say it wrong. You can make it very nervous by all. I have two daughters.
Yeah.
The only reason why they eventually grow over it lies back to me. Our Western culture is based on the Greek culture, right? All our cultures are all based on Greek culture. We very often say like from a Roman culture or a German culture or something like this, but the Greek culture was very pervasive, even all the way to the Vikings. The Vikings were a Greek culture, and they were a subculture of the Greek. And it started with the idea, first of all, that the world is made up out of islands, because Greece was made out of islands. And every island was a country at that time. And every country was fighting with every other country. So if you were coming from the one island, you didn't like people from the other island. So you were fighting, you were making war. On the basis of this culture, we see the history of Europe as an island country. Now we have all the...
Like Sustu. I can use all your...
Oh my
God.
I hope not. Broken? No, nothing happened.
Still playing though?
Yeah.
That's weird.
Same thing happened
all the time. Yeah.
Here?
Okay. Okay, we're playing here, right? So we talk about the elements and the island culture. And this island culture, they represent themselves in the different countries from Europe. They're all the time fighting with each other. And you have the idea of nationalism. It's typical island culture philosophy, right? And all the countries in the world together, they all represent the same island culture. All cultures basically follow a Greek model of thinking, right? So it means everybody's Greek, first of all, in some way. All the European cultures, for sure, they're all Greek cultures. And everybody who comes from there, who has a Western origin countries, they have all Greek culture in their nature, so they all are born to create wars, fighting, conflicts, arguments, and so on and so forth. And in science, it was represented by the fact that they saw things as built from atoms, like the smallest indivisible particle, but usually called
atoms. Yeah.
Atoms, atoma. In Greek, it's called atoma. And these atoma were recognized as being earth atoma, a fire atoma, and a water atoma, and an air atoma. That's it. There were four building blocks, and everything was built from atoma. So in different atoma, they were piled together like things, and then something else would be created. and then later time, in the late years, you had the particles from shows how you can mix up cultures and then get something really weird. Because our modern science depends on his thinking. And so he said, well, atoms are very pure things, but four is not enough. You need a fifth one. So he came up with the idea of ether. Yes? And the Catholic Church absorbed that also in its philosophy and says, these atoms are right. And then his students, the second or third generation of students of Paracelsus, they said, like, look, you can make medicines from these things, but Paracelsus said, as a doctor, you can only use pure things to cure things, like a sulfur. We talked about sulfur the other day, sulfur is one thing. And they said, well, if you make impurities, then you can still get results. It's not as strong, but you still get a result. And our modern chemistry is based on the idea that you create polluted things to create health, which is a paradox. So Paracelsus was very much against. But that's the basics of chemistry. You create pollutions to create health. Right? So now you understand where the elements come from, what they are. They are building blocks. And if you mix them, and you mix them in a particular way, then they still are pure. But if you mix them in another way, they become impure, and the impurities then are eliminations. Right? So it's like you see a piece of amber, and there is a small dirty thing in it, and that's an insect. And then it's called beautiful because of the insect is whole. So the insect is pure, and the amber is pure too. But if you see a diamond, and it has a fleck on it,
yeah.
Have you seen diamonds too close and there's a spot
in
it? It immediately degrades the value because it's a dirt. Right? It is something that's not diamond, it's and it's not beautiful too. So then the diamond becomes less valuable. And so our medications, they are less valuable things. They hope that you get healthier. But these atoma in itself, they are building blocks and you pile them up and you can build basically anything in the cosmos. But that was the idea. And our whole modern physics is based on the same idea. They said that they would go look for the atoma and then they said, like, oh, there's actually not five elements, but there's like a whole table of elements. And then they found that if you take the elements apart, you have even smaller elements, and even smaller elements, and even smaller elements, and you have loads of smaller. Depending on how hard you collide them, you get more and more elements over time. And they're all smaller than the ones that you know. Some of them are even virtual, they're not even real elements, but they appear there also. They have no basis, but they are there. Right? So it's a very unreal reality that we now created from just looking at conflict. And you need conflict to understand the details of it. Right? So they bounce things together. That's the elemental theory of the West. Chinese elemental theory, on the other hand, is based on a nation which, in the warring states period before the Qin Dynasty, the Wuxing and Yinyang theory came together, there were a few states that were warring with each other. They had different theories. Like one state was having the Wuxing theory, one state was having the Yinyang theory, another state was having the Sansai theory, and so on and so on. They all had different ideas, and the Qin Empire managed to conquer all of them. In this period, it was a very bloody period of China, almost all major classical philosophy was written. And it all was about unification. So they were looking all the time, like, how do you unify things? Right? And the Wuxing theory is a unification theory. How do you unify things? Right? So it's the opposite of the five element or the four element theory as we used in the West. In Indian theory, there is a transcendence theory, and they are piled on top of each other. So you go from really very coarse, and then you go finer and finer and finer and finer until eventually you're rarefied and you become identified with Brahmanatman. After you first go to five stages, which by Westerners are named after the five elements of Paracelsus. Right? So ether is the most etheric one, and under that is air and fire and water and earth. Right? Well, in Chinese culture, for instance, if you put water and fire together and fire involves water, then there's no communication, so there's a split, and it's not possible to overcome the split. So then the transformation process would already stop.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So there are differences in approach in how they perceive things. So this transcendent theory is just a matter of letting go of your body. Right? So the one theory is a building block theory, the other theory is a letting go of your body theory. Just become, you know, one without another. You give everything up and you just become part of God. And that's the opposite process. process of Christianity. I don't know if you know the creation myth of the West very much, but you see that God at a certain point started leaking at the bottom. And yeah, that's very funny. The Kabbalah theory actually is based on that same idea, right? But it's a later extrapolation. But then he started leaking and going for different layers of self-existence. And at a certain point, at the lowest level that is possible to leak, he flushed out Plenola, like what we do in our intestines. And this was the material where souls are made.
The souls are made from?
Yes. And people got souls. So this Pleroma got out and then got souls, and then that means they got human bodies. And this theory comes somewhere from, you know, the Arab Peninsula or somewhere around, could even come from India, nobody really knows. Right? So the theory is already very old and relates to theories like Zoroastrianism and Jansenism and a few other schools of thought, all from this area that are the foundation of things like Hinduism, Buddhism, Ayurveda, Vedic culture and stuff like this. And Islam also at the same time. Right? In China, they went into a completely different direction. They said, like, you know, these wuxing, there are interactions with each other. This is the way how things communicate, or the way how things consume, how things eat, or how they give birth, right? And then, if you would translate it in the West, then wuxing itself, you will best translate as like this, like that, right? So, if you say, take the fire, what we usually call fire element, it's not a fire building block, but it is something that eats like firewood. So it needs wood to become a fire. So it needs to feed on fire. So fire doesn't exist if there's not also wood. Right? So that means there has to be something that it can eat from, and it's always wood. But wood needs water to grow. So you need enough water to grow enough wood so that the fire can burn. Right? But where does the water come from? The water needs matter. Yes, now I'm going to stop here for a moment because this is going to be very exciting later. Because this is part of the theory, the exciting part is part of the theory. I just start feeling like I'm talking to children sometimes. The stories over time I make it more and more exciting.
Maybe.
But it's the reality of things. It's just a very exciting because it's something that nobody ever talks about. And it's one of the big secrets basically of the Muslim theory. So that's why I stop here for now. So it's a cliffhanger. On the other side, the fire that eats the wood, you know, after the wood is being burned, what's left? There's ashes. If you have enough ashes, you have soil, you have earth, right? If the earth becomes dense enough, because there's like really big heap of earth, right, then the inside is much more dense than the outside. And in the denseness, you get metal ore. You know, you get the foundation of jade, of gold, of silver, and so on and so on. So it's all being based on pressure. That's their theory. Of course, now for physics, we know that in the earth core, you get all the pressure from stones, and then you get all kind of materials being produced. Some materials, like in iridium, you only get from meteors. You don't get on the earth. So you only get from space, right? So your mobile phone is partly a meteor, right? And it's partly gold. And then at the moment when you look at it, you see there's ore, it's just there, right? Nothing happens with it. And then they say, yeah, and then from ore becomes metal, like a mirror or something like this, and then that condenses water. But the thing is, somebody has to make a mirror. And that's you, right? That's the past difference. So you are the one that handles the music. That's part of the theory. Everybody talks about it like it's a circle, but it's not so. It's you who understands how things relate to each other. Sort of like when you play billiards, now you can move one ball to another ball to another ball to another ball until eventually it comes into your mouth. Right? That's basically it. Because the balls are, you know, meatballs. Just a joke. But you understand the principle.
Yeah, you are part of
the... Yes, you create a chain. You're part of it, but you create a chain. You are a creator of a chain,
yeah.
Right? So without you, there is no Muslim. Right? You understand that? There's no Muslim without you. In nature, there's no Muslim without you. It stops with ashes. It stops with metal ore. Right? There happens to be water.
Metal is
ore.
Metal.
So it stops with metal ore, basically. And by itself, it doesn't happen. And some earth, some water comes from the earth, from the ground, yes?
Yeah.
But that's not enough to feed everything. Right? The whole process of existence.
And how does metal ore make water? By the mirror.
Yeah, you make a mirror, and then because of the mirror, it condenses water from the
sun. So the human being is the mirror?
No, the human being makes the mirror.
How?
By melting the metal ore.
Oh.
So the metal ore is being taken out, you take fire, you put it first into a earth cup, so you use the earth again, right? And then you put the earth, you put the fire in there, and you put the metal ore in there. So you take first the metal ore out, you put it on top, you put the fire in there, you blow, that's the wood, wind, also at the same time, right? And then you create a mirror. In the mirror, you put against the sun or against the moon, and you get a particular kind of water, and that feeds the plants.
Wow.
Right? The plants feed the wood. So yeah, this is how you make the cycle run.
So we all are a little bit of God.
You're all a little bit part of the creation.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, yes. So and that's what it tries to describe. It tries to describe where your will comes from, where your will is, yeah? Your action. So there's nothing in the world that happens, in your world, that happens without you wanting something, doing something, planning something, organizing something, or forgetting to organize something, because then things just fall apart, right? That's basically what it is, right? Then it relates to the yinyang theory. The yinyang theory is basically the creation process. In the oldest classics, it's been described as the fact that you see in nature, there's only two forces. One is expanding, one is contracting. And when you see heaven and earth, when they separate, you see that the earth is the condensing, the coagulation of matter, basically of things. And it collides together and it becomes more and more tight. But that's where the wall comes from the inside, because of the pressure from the metal. Your bones are in your body are seen as earth, because your bones are the most dense part. So your body, when you exercise it, because of that, your bones become more condensed, and then you get metal ore on the inside. So they say on the outside soft, on the inside like metal. Right? And because of the heat of the body of the dantian, you create in the bones, you create a mirror, so that you can moisten your body. Right? Mm-hmm. So that's one part of it. Then the other part is that heaven, you know, expands all the time, and they describe it as the moral quality of being magnanimous. That means you allow everything. Yeah? You have no comments about it. You just allow everything. And they say if you can be like heaven, yeah, you can also never die. Because the heaven is always there. So your magnanimousness, your behavior of you know allowing everything, not trying to get in the way of anything, just allowing things to happen as they are, this is part of it. How many times don't we try to influence things? So every time we influence things, we try to influence things. We make a joke in the car about being a therapist, being a manipulator. Yes. Every time when you manipulate something, when you try to control something, you die a little more. That's what it basically says. Yes. So it's very hard, of course, not to try to influence things. But then these two, they are, you know, they're not related to each other. Heaven goes that way, earth goes that way. But in the heavens, you have the stars, you have the sun, and the moon, and these have also all kind of workings. And these stars, there's five moving stars. These are the five sign, yeah, the five stars. Sounds the same like form, right? Different rhythm. But it sounds the same, so there's a relationship between them. That's how the theory works. So the five stars, yeah, they are the influences of our faith, for what's going to happen. Because there's gods living there, and they say like, anyway, you drink another wine today. I'm going to cut off a little bit of your liver every day.